I am encouraged that all of you all are here participating in this kind of learning, because so many of these details have been left out, and no one really gets this information unless you really specialize and you delve into history. And even then, finding the resources of a recorded history is very limited, and we're not written by a lot of people of color. Brett had told me that I'd be discussing our immigration issues here in the Western Hemisphere and in the United States, and so that's why I started with this particular slide. And this is, you know, a joke. It's sort of a spoof that we've been fighting immigration and Homeland Security since 1492. It's true, and yet it's even more profound as we talk about. He did a little joke about we should have built the wall.
Yeah.
But as you well know, or you've heard on the news, most of the undocumented immigrants right now are flying in, and they're aging. They're not coming across the Rio Grande. They're not actually coming up from Mexico. We have the same scenario that happened here. You can go to the next slide. We have the same scenario that happened here in the Western Hemisphere. Who are we? We're the indigenous people of the entire Western Hemisphere. We knew each other in the entire hemisphere for thousands of years. So this was a land that we were living in. We say the Creator gave it to us. We have lots of different myths and legends that go back to say how we got here. It's been trained and taught, going to the next slide, that indigenous people came across that Bering Strait from Asia. And so there are people that are apologetics that will say, oh, well, we're not from here either. We migrated here. But we've been saying that we're indigenous here much longer than has been taught. Could human beings really have been in North America 50,000 years ago? That first reading that you got to, this, of course, is what happened in 1492, which starts our historic record. This is how we get codified. This is how they end up renaming us or misnomering us as a Native American or American Indian because of Cristobal Colon in 1492, you know, landing with the Taino or the Arawak people. You can go to the next slide. But we were 90 to 100 million people in the Western Hemisphere in all of the Americas. 90 to 100 million people at the point of contact, historic contact with Europe. This whole theory has been proved to be true for some of the tribal groups, the Athabascan folks. So those folks that we call Navajo in the Southwest are related to those Asiatic people of Siberia. Linguistically, they're Athabascan speakers. But we here, all the way on the East Coast, have been saying we didn't necessarily come across that Bering Strait. Now, how did we get here? That's almost irrelevant. This was our land base at that time of contact. You can go to the next slide. And so Al Goodyear, a colleague of mine, I have an anthropology degree and have worked as an anthropologist, but I'm a cultural anthropologist. I didn't want to get into digging up our ancestors, but I had to do a little bit of that for my credentials and for my degree. But Al Goodyear, a colleague of mine here, just recently has proven that we were indigenous and we were here much longer or much before the Clovis period. And so we were here long before the Woodland, long before the Mississippian, long before they thought that we were actually here in the Western Hemisphere. And we were right here in South Carolina. And we were, of course, combating with mastodons. We had our own version of a camel.
Saber-toothed tigers.
We were here. People were here. My ancestors were here. Some of your ancestors were here.
25,000 years ago?
So it goes back 13 to 15,000 years ago. There's debate specifically as to where and when. And of course, they're using carbon dating to figure that out. But occupation in North America drastically alters the notions that we had of who the indigenous people are. Quite often, they use those notions to validate their manifest destiny and the fact that they could come here and take it from us. No. But they do. They use it as validation that they divinely had some communication with divine principle, the creator, as though we were created by the same one, and that their creator told them that they could come take it. It's not unlike those folks that traipsed out of Egypt and went to Canaanite country and just started taking stuff, and then they want to claim the Palestinians weren't living there too. Very similar to that debate. Who was there first? Yeah, we were here first. So y'all were taking land, or someone was taking land. So it goes back 60,000 to 80,000 years ago. We were here. Your second reading, of course, deals with, you can go to the next slide. I've intermingled some of these slides so that you can understand, because I think that it would not be prudent for me to talk about the ancient past without bringing it to a contemporary time for you, so that you know that you're dealing with people that are still living today. We have to make history relevant to our students so that they can actually connect the dots to contemporary people. You're walking down the street, you would not know that I was Native American upon seeing me walking down the street. But we are still among you. These are some of the contemporary tribes and urban groups of North Carolina, which was part of South Carolina, to the next one. And here tells you all of the Southeast. I showed you that map of our Southeastern complex, because all of us are related. We were what I call teepee hopping. That means we were procreating. We were sharing culture. We had the same ceremonies, same ways of expressing ourselves, same stomp dances, same sports. We were all doing stickball games, or what you call lacrosse. We were doing a lot of the same stuff in this entire region. We're all related, even though there are various different linguistic families and whatnot amongst us. The Iroquois, I'm Southern Iroquois, us Tuscaroras and Nottoways and Cherokees, all of us are Southern Iroquois. We have the Suwan, we have the Muscogean. You have a great article about a Muscogean community that was right just north of here. Hernandez Soto comes traipsing through here about 1540. He stops right here at the Saluda River, right near the Gervais Street Bridge. He stops, he keeps going north. He goes up like Route 1 toward Camden. He stops at the Walmart. The Walmart, right behind it is the Mulberry Plantation. That's where the queen of Cotopaxi, that's where she was. Why is she so prominent? Maybe because Spaniards talked about her. Was she the only female sovereign? No. But it was important to them because they had left Europe, and guess what? There was Queen Elizabeth, but they called her a queen. We never called her queen. Then when they don't want to call her queen, they called her the lady. She was a lady that people were carrying on a litter. You know, they came, they said, hello, take me to your leader. And they said, you just wait right here, we'll bring her to you. She showed up that way, they met her, they ate them out of house and home, they ate all their food, and they said, where's the next village? She said, let's get these folks out of here. She escorted them to the next village. They had people that were enslaved from Africa with them. She ends up, and it's interesting how these things work. We accepted folks knowing that we were all part of the human family. So two-legged, we knew they were two-legged, that they were children of God too, but we knew they were sketchy. And she ends up getting bonds with those that were enslaved with the Spaniards, and she runs off with them and leaves the Spaniards traipsing all the way up toward Catawba and or the Waxhaw and North Carolina and whatnot. You can go to the next slide. But we have 13 different tribal communities that are state recognized here in this state. We have one federal tribe, the Catawbas. Those are the contemporary people. A lot of the tribes up here in North Carolina are related to these down here, or we're related to them, vice versa, because we didn't have these borders, that were created much later. And so we actually had natural, familial connections to them. About 12 of the tribes in this state have actual historic connections to the tribes here. When they validated their history for state recognition in this state, their progenitors actually came in from North Carolina. They were following the waterways or following jobs. The Cherokee were already here. The Catawbas or the Waxaw or the Wateree, the Congaree down here, all those are the same people, Suwan speakers, they're all related. You can go to the next slide. Here are a lot of the ancient tribes. Circa 1675, I know that we're going up to 1860.
We're doing 1860 today.
1860 today. This is 1675, and you'll see lots of different names. The Siwi, the Santee, the Congaree, the Wateree. Those are the indigenous people that you find mentioned in not only the essay that I wrote about genocide, but in even these are the ones on the coast that were included in the slave laws of this state. We were enslaved people. So, let me go to the next slide. A lot of these names are related to a geographic location. Just like when you go to Britain, you meet British people. We have connections to our land base too. So people that are referred to as the PD here are referred that way because they're on the PD River, basically. They were being named for their lands of either bodies of water or their land base, you know, that kind of thing. Not unlike other people. Let me go to the next slide. Now, the removal, which is discussed in your thing, is something that we always teach in South Carolina history, as though in 1838 we all picked up and left. Well, I'm still here, and our descendants are people that never left. We could call ourselves the unconquered ones because we didn't leave. But we're the diaspora because the body politic group ended up leaving. I'm descended of John Ross, who was the chief of the Cherokees at that time. He was 7/8 Scottish and 1/8 Cherokee. Because we had bad immigration laws then. We acknowledging the human factor had taken in a whole lot of people of Scottish, Irish, people of African descent, and had naturalized them and made them part of our nation, the Cherokee Nation, which had half of South Carolina all the way down to the Broad River, Georgia, Alabama, Tennessee, Virginia, North Carolina. We had about 7 states. Go to the next slide. This was our country, so to speak, or our territory. We didn't have borders then. We didn't believe in land ownership, but that was our territory, all the way down here to the Midlands. You never see this in history books. They always talk about the last historic period where we had our last treaty in 1816 in Oconee County, which is where my great-great-grandfather was. You never hear that we were all the way down right here, and that we were the frontier with regard to trade. 26 replicates our trade path going down to Charleston. We traded. We were living in harmony for thousands of years. So when you read these stories about the Catawbas being our enemies, they only became our enemies after we aligned with European people and how they played us against each other. We've been living for thousands of years. We all had popcorn. We all had grits. We got it from the Yucatan. We did. This was our country. So that's the amount of states that we had. Part of Virginia, West Virginia, Kentucky, Tennessee, Alabama, Georgia. Our seat of government was right here in Georgia. But we had a capital right here at Lake Kiawe, up in the upcountry of South Carolina as well. They did international meetings of trade and discussion there, where tribes came all the way down from Canada to meet there in Kiawe. In the historic period, you can go to the next slide. All of these tribes down here are related to each other. We discussed the big Yamasee War. That's something that we continue to teach in our social studies program for third and fourth graders. It is an important war. Why is it so important? Because it was a war where a whole lot of indigenous and native people said, oh no. And they all decided to work together to fight. And then they were gotten rid of. Are there any Yamasee here today? Not really. We have a small group in Allendale that moved back into the state in the last 20 years. And are they really Yamasee? I'm not sure. So, but all of these people, the Etowah, the Edisto, what we call the Edisto Indians, the Etowah, because it's Cassavo, that whole confederacy, the Cuso, the Natchez moved up from Mississippi, joined them. You need to know that those people and their descendants still are here today and are still victims of civil injustice. These are people that are first generation out of segregated schools. These are brown people. These are not the ones that walk around, oh, my great-great-grandmother was a Cherokee apprentice and they have blonde hair. These are some brown people. I'm going to show you some pictures of them in the upcoming. Next slide. So, you know, we go back, you can go forward or back, depending on how you want to look at it. How many millions of years we were here? B.C., A.D., and archaeologists and anthropologists are reconstructing how we lived, what we lived in, what kind of commerce we did, what our foodstuffs were, what our building structures, our architectural, what our arts looked like, what kind of political system we had, whether we were matriarchal, whether we were patriarchal. Archaeologists and anthropologists are reconstructing a lot of that as they do their digs. But they also have found, of course, some ancestral remains that they've done DNA studies, and they have actually traced us back very, very far to Native people today. So we are actually descendants of these people by DNA, scientific. You can go to the next one. This is another way of looking at it. We're actually descendants. You can go to the next one. However you can best conceptualize it and understand it, whether the bar chart helps you or, you know, here we are in modern time. That's as much history that we actually have recorded, and it's recorded badly, like I said. All of that's unrecorded. But they were humans and people throughout this time who had their own struggles as far as survival. Go to the next one. This just once again reinforces how related we all are in this Mississippian culture and how we were all doing the same things. You can go to the next one. Next one. Recall Eastern Woodlands, related to all those people. Cherokees migrated down from Michigan, Canada, and come into the Southeast before we get that one big plot of land that's called our country right down here. So we're related to them linguistically. Way before history, probably earlier than 1300, we migrate down. One of the readings said that the Catawbas were there just a few years before Europeans came to York County, just a few years before. But that's not really kosher. Because Catawbas have connections all the way to the Pamunkeys of Virginia. Contemporarily, Keith Brown and people that you know are connected to Pocahontas' people. You know who she is. You can go to the next one. Lots of diversity in who we are. We don't all look alike. We're not all the same people. We're related to the Maya, Olmec, Aztecas. Like I said, Cherokees are a hybrid. We're part Iroquoian that migrated down linguistically in our cosmology. And then we have Yucatan ancestry and bloodline. So we created a culture from people that came together. You can go. Next one. This is the pathway of Hernan de Soto. So he came traipsing through here, and then he ends up going all the way around and going through Georgia, going through North Carolina. And as he went places, he did all kinds of things. Like, he gave us our name, Cherokee. That's not our real name. We call ourselves Anuminya. So when you look at the history book, you have to realize that it tells you a story, but you have to realize who the storyteller is. Okay, next one.
Just a little more back. Hello?
There's Columbia. Okay, I'll go to this side. There's Columbia. There's the lady right there. She's prominent. We find her in children's books. We find her in history books. They were surprised that a woman was important and found a place in our culture and was a ruler. So you have a wonderful article that talks about gender and all kinds of things like that. But you have to think of it and look at it from a European bias that was marginalizing their women. Okay, next one. There she is. She's depicted in art. Next one. This is a little bit more relevant to you all. It tells you the villages. It tells you, theoretically, how many people or natives they thought were in those villages. It tells you how connected we all are. The watery wax saw end up becoming what we call today Isla or Catawba, the Congaree, the Chiraw. All these are part of their people. They're also related to the people that are the largest Indian community currently in the southeast, which is the Lumbee Indians of the Chiraw, because they're right here on this Mecklenburg border right here. The Hatteras and all these people, Tuscarora is in the central part of the state. They end up being captured and being exported out of Charleston and enslaved to work in sugar plantations. The Waccamaw people that we have called Waccamaw today are really not Waccamaw. They're the Dimery settlement. They're really descendants of North Carolinians, but they picked up a name because of where they live after they migrated down here. So, you can go to the next one. What do we look like today? Who are being disenfranchised? Who are the first generation out of those one-room schoolhouses? I have an article in there about the enslaved, you know, the native victims of slavery. That story's never told. You know, the big American myth is we were good. We couldn't do the work on the plantation. So they went and got the robust people of Africa. No, we were smart. We knew where to hide and run. Okay, this was our land base.
You lived here.
This was our land base. They couldn't contain us successfully, but they did. All the way up to 1865, natives were emancipated with the Emancipation Proclamation II. One matriarch of the Waspasaw tribe of Varnertown, she is their matriarch because she was an enslaved Indian Mary on a plantation of a guy named William Varner. And he, being him like an Indian woman, had had a whole bunch of children by this slave they didn't marry. And he said, upon my death, I will not only give her freedom, but her children, but I want them to have this land, which is part of our plantation. And that is their tribal community today, called Barnertown. Named for him, it's his children.
Where is this?
It's in a Monk's Corner, on 17. So Indian Mary was an emancipated slave at the time of emancipation.